Good. Well, I've been for a meeting with the President of the Parliament. It's what's described generally as an interview without coffee. We had a fairly frank discussion. He and I debated what freedom of speech means. And we both agreed that freedom of speech is very important, but we have different definitions of what freedom of speech is. My interpretation of freedom of speech is that the limits upon it are that you cannot incite violence, but that it is perfectly fair to criticise other people, and especially to do so in a parliament. That is not President Buzek's interpretation of free speech, and he says that I've undermined the dignity of the parliament. I responded to that by making clear that even in their own Charter of Fundamental Rights, which has just been approved as part of the Lisbon Treaty, Article 11 says that people should be able to speak freely without any institutions stopping them from doing so. We've reached an impasse. The upshot of it is this. I've been asked to apologise to Herman van Rompuy. I've been asked to apologise to the European Parliament. And I've been asked to apologise to the people of Belgium. And I've had time to reflect. I had a short period of time to reflect. And I've decided that I will make an apology. But the only people I'm going to apologise to are bank clerks the world over. And if I've offended them, I'm very sorry indeed. But I'm not going to apologise to Herman van Rompuy. I'm not going to apologise to the European Parliament. I'm certainly not going to apologise to the people of Belgium. And as a result of that, the President has said that he won't let this sort of thing happen again. What a democratic institution this is, isn't it? He won't let it happen again, and he will let me know shortly of what my penalty will be. So I am assuming that he will suspend me for a period of time from the Parliament. I'm assuming he will try, through the Conference of Presidents, to get my position as leader of a group in the Parliament taken away. And all I can say is that those of us that have battled against the European institutions on the basis that they were becoming fundamentally undemocratic have been proved to be right. I have not used unparliamentary language. I have not incited dislike or hatred. I have merely expressed an opinion, and in doing so, there is now actually a debate about who is Herman van Rompuy, why is he being paid more than Obama, and just what powers has he got. And I'm not going to apologise if what I've said sparked a debate of right throughout the European Union about these institutions.
But you insulted him.
I don't think that's insulting. I mean, compared with the sort of insult that I've had in this Parliament from the leaders of the other groups, I don't think that the two compare. And frankly, you know, what Mr. Van Rompuy wants to do is to take away from us our democracy and our rights of self-government. You can't do that without us as elected members coming back and saying we're not very happy about it.
Is it possible to say without personally insulting someone, without saying, describing him as a dandrag?
Well, I think you have the charisma of a dandrag, and I challenge you to find anybody who listened to that speech in the European Parliament.
While many people might agree with the sentiment of what you're saying, wasn't the tone, I mean, you started off by saying, I don't mean to be rude, and then went on to be fantastic.
No, I wasn't quite fantastic. Goodness me, if you compare what happens in the House of Commons every week, if you compare what goes on in the Australian Parliament, I mean, this was pretty mild stuff. But the point is that in the European Parliament, they don't want any criticism at all. No criticism of the Union, no criticism of the appointees. They can't put up with any alternative argument. Well, I'm sorry, that is not the way to build the United States of Europe. Either you do it with consent, free speech and democracy, or you don't do it at all.
Did you not regret at all what you said about Belgium?
Well, I mean, look, what I said about Belgium is as nothing compared to the current Belgian Prime Minister, Mr. Leterme, who himself said in August 2006, he said that the French speakers didn't have the intelligence to learn Dutch. And he said that all that united the Flemings and the Walloons was the king, football and beer. So, I mean, that's the Prime Minister of Belgium saying things like that. And I've actually been avalanche with emails from people in Belgium agreeing with me that the sooner it splits to the constituent parts, the better.
If the President would have been Mr. Balkenende, what would you have said?
Well, if the President had been somebody of stature, then the European Union's promise to put in place a president that had the ability to stop the traffic in Beijing and Washington may well have been true. I don't think this bloke can stop the traffic in Brussels, quite frankly. So you know, they have these lofty aspirations of having a voice on the world stage. But as we've seen already with Obama snubbing Herman van Rompuy, they haven't got that. Now, on the one hand, of course, I'm quite pleased about that. as a Eurosceptic, I don't particularly want them to have this big global voice, but it's clear to me that what he will concentrate on is what's happening within the European Union, and in that speech, in that Parliament, he made it very clear that he wants to put in place an economic government for the whole of the European Union. That is something that nobody, the British, the French, Germans, Dutch, or anybody, has given consent to.
Given the chance, would you say the same thing again, or would you actually go further?
Well, I think I was pretty moderate, really. I mean, given what he wants to do to us, I think I was very moderate. No, I mean, I don't like to sort of go too far with these things. I think I made my point, and I reiterate, I'm not going to apologise if I've sparked up a debate about vital issues such as who governs the European Union and are they democratically accountable. I think that's a good thing to have done.
But there's really a contradiction. On the one hand, you don't want strong EU institutions. On the second hand, you are criticising him for not having charisma.
I'm criticising.
Thank you for not having cards.
I am criticising the European institutions who promised us a traffic stopper, who promised us a global leader, and they haven't got it. So it's perfectly fair to point that out. But I did say in the second part of the speech that I did know that he was an intelligent and competent man, and that I was deeply concerned that he was a quiet assassin of democracy and of nation states.
Are you going to accept your sanction?
Yes.
Some of your supporters of your comments about Belgium have gone to plank. Kind of allies.
Well, you know, you can't choose in politics who it is that you're supporting, and I'm not surprised that we've got comments from them. After all, they are a separatist group, but there are many separatist groups within the Flemish group. So, I mean, I'm not surprised by that one. And look, there aren't even national political parties in Belgium. You know, I mean, this really is, I'm sorry, but it really is a bit of a long country. And I certainly won't apologise for that. I've been making speeches like this in the European Parliament since 2004, and if I'm now being told that I'm not allowed to exercise free speech in Parliament, that would mean that I couldn't expose the fact that someone like Jack Barrow, who was a commissioner in the last term, was a convicted fraud. Is this a Parliament? Is this a democratic European Union? Or are we not allowed to say what we really feel? Whatever they do to me, whether they fine me, whether they suspend me from the Parliament, whatever they do to me, I will appeal. Yes, I will, because I think the issue of free speech is hard.
What did you do to the and how would you describe his life?
Well, I like President Buzek. I think he is a genuinely decent man. But I think that he's in a difficult position in this Parliament. You've got the big group leaders screaming at him to do something about this ghastly Farage bloke. I mean, people like Schultz, who leads the Party of European Socialists, who doesn't believe in democracy at all. In fact, whenever there's a referendum result that goes the other way, he says we must not bow to populism. So they're the kind of people putting pressure upon him, and now he's got this Belgian Prime Minister, the one who 3 years ago thought Belgium should be split up, now demanding an apology. So I think the President is in a very difficult position. Okay.
Could you just elaborate a little bit on why you think Mr. Van Rompuy is a quiet assassin? What exactly are his plans?
Oh, he's, I mean, you know, he has not been in the job very long, but it was perfectly clear in that speech. If you could stay awake to listen to it, and that wasn't easy, believe you me, and the chamber was virtually empty, so it just goes to show what most of the European Parliament think about this man. But he made it clear that he wants to put together economic government to Europe. And my argument is that nobody has ever given consent to that. Okay, a couple more and then we'll be done. No? Good? Would you...
I mean, the sanctions you've outlined are the most severe. I mean, it's much more likely you just...
I don't know. I mean, I did receive an official reprimand in November, so this has been an ongoing battle, and that was because I said that Herman van Rompuy and Baroness Ashton were political pygmies, and I was reprimanded for that. No, I think the atmosphere in the room, the atmosphere throughout the meeting, was such that he was pretty clear that unless I apologised to Herman van Rompuy, people of Belgium and the European Parliament, that what would happen to me would be severe, and he did say, I will not allow this sort of thing to happen again.
But it's not going to do you any harm, is it, if you can portray yourself as a martyr to free speech?
Look, I've been making these speeches for years in the European Parliament. Up until now, they have tried their best to ignore me. For some reason, now they're not ignoring me. And I suspect that's because they know, the people running the EU know, that this attempt to build a United States of Europe does not have popular consent right across the European Union. So what they do to me is pretty small beer compared with that.
What's the history of your reprimands?
Well, as I say, I've been ignored up until... I mean, obviously I've been called a football hooligan, a lager lout, I've been called mentally ill, I've been compared with fascists. I mean, all sorts of appalling abuse. But it's just been abuse. The first time that any official action was ever taken against me was in November of last year when I had a referendum.
So you're not going to apologise to the people? Could you just explain a little bit why?
Well, I'm not going to apologise to the people. I have no wish to cause any offence to the people that have been done. But I'm being asked to apologise for saying that it's pretty much a non-country. And I repeat, you know, it does not have political parties. Its own Prime Minister, on its national day last year, when asked to sing the national anthem, sang the Marseillaise, because he didn't even know what it was. I mean, goodness me, he's the one that should apologise, not me.